Welcome, everyone. We're just going to wait a minute or so here and allow a few more people to come in, and then we'll get started. All right, let's go ahead and get started. Hello, everybody. Philip Yeske, the Science and Alliance Officer at UMDF. Really excited and a real pleasure to be here with you today to provide this update on a really significant initiative that UMDF launched earlier this year, mitoSHARE. And we've invited those who are already participants in the registry to attend this, to start to get some feedback on the kinds of data that we're collecting. But importantly, we've also invited the entire community to join. And hopefully there's a number of you on the call that are curious about mitoSHARE and perhaps haven't joined yet. Part of the goal here is to share with you enough about the registry that you'll at least consider going ahead and creating an account and being a part of what we're trying to accomplish with mitoSHARE. So generally speaking, the theme for today is what we've learned and what comes next. We're 6 months into this project and it's still very much the early days. In the course of over the next half hour or so, I'd like to just start a little bit with, again, reinforcing why patient registries are so important. What we've learned, both leading up to the launch of mitoSHARE and in the past 6 months. And then just as important is what does the future look like? And that's very much a roadmap that's still being written, but I'd love to share with you just some of the near-term goals. So to start with just why patient registries, the patient voice is really at the center of why patient-populated registries like mitoSHARE are so important. This is the opportunity to collect data that's complementary to what clinicians may be providing based on health assessments. We have the opportunity, because we're a very close disease community, to identify and characterize patients from the patient perspective. And that's the sort of front of mind always, and whatever we're doing with the registry, is that this is your registry and we need to know where you are, who you are, and hopefully you decide to share your data. And our commitment is then to facilitate research based on that data in an appropriate way, which begins with only de-identified data will be shared. And you always have the right to remove yourself from the registry if you no longer want to be involved. So proper oversight of the registry, again, core principle of what we're trying to accomplish here. Ultimately, our goal is to try and drive treatments and cures for mitochondrial disease. And to do that, clinical trials are required. And for clinical trials to be successful, we need as many patients identified and characterized as possible. So that's where the registry fits. As we continue to grow it, it will play a role in helping to present clinical trial opportunities to the participants so that we can advance these therapeutics, hopefully to treatments that are available soon. So a reminder that this isn't new for UMDF. I look back over 25 years and you can see even in the early days, Chuck Mohan and many others saw the importance of knowing where the patients are and characterizing those patients. And they were done in very different ways, faxing information across, et cetera. But through the years, there's always been some component of finding and characterizing the patients. In 2014, We launched our first online registry called the Mitochondrial Disease Community Registry. We ran that for 5 years, and there were a lot of learnings that came from that. In fact, published a paper in 2020 that summarizes some of the learnings of what's important to patients that participate in patient registries. So as we started to think about what next, what did we want to do next to really take registry activities for mitochondrial disease to a whole nother level, we thought about a couple different components. One, how can you use the registry to optimize patient care? We know how challenging that is. That was one of the learnings and what we heard very clearly from the patients that participated in MDCR. And this concept of co-production of care, that the voice of the patient is equally as important as the voice of the clinician. And so it's co-production of care. It shouldn't be the clinician telling the patient. It certainly shouldn't be the patient telling the clinician. It has to be co-production. It's a two-way communication level. So choosing a platform and building a registry that facilitated that was, again, front of mind. On the registry side, it's very important to facilitate research. I'm the science officer here. This is what I think about every day, is how to advance our research mission. But registries also afford the opportunity to provide support tools. So it's not just about collecting the data to advance research. How can we create a registry that also provides a suite of tools to the participants to perhaps make their life easier? And so we'll talk about some of those tools here today. And then again, patient-centered research, meaning that we can collect the information and begin to build the case for why certain types of research should be conducted with the patients at the front of that process. So in building out the next registry, these were the kinds of things we were thinking about. I've got three sort of silos here, if you will, in terms of the types of accounts. We knew we wanted to create a registry that covered young to old, those just suspected of having mitochondrial disease, all the way to a confirmed genetic diagnosis. And importantly, we also wanted to capture the caregiver guardian perspective in terms of taking care of a loved one with mitochondrial disease. When you start to think about data types, this could be a much longer list, but at the very heart of it, we can run demographic surveys, again, to help us understand who the patients are and what their makeup is. Genomic data, very important for what fundamentally are rare inherited genetic diseases. Electronic health records are a wealth of information, but how do you navigate them? How do you centralize them and perhaps start to pull key data out of them? So we knew electronic health records need to be a part of anything in the year 2022 and going forward. Excuse me, patient reported outcome measures are really important in terms of standardized metrics for understanding the patient perspective that can then be used in regulatory filings or anything related to clinical trial readiness. But we also wanted to create a registry that was a robust research database such that investigators could approach mitoSHARE about specific projects, presenting that to the community and collecting data from the community, but only after appropriate approvals. And we'll talk about that in the next one. Natural history studies are very important. That helps us understand the progression of the disease. And as I think everyone on this webinar knows, mitochondrial disease is not monolithic. It's not one disease. It's a collection of diseases. And because of that, we need a lot of data to be able to understand how that disease changes over time in a lot of different scenarios. So really important to collect data to advance that. And this happens longitudinal, that means over time. But again, from the caregiver perspective, what does social support look like? What does quality of life look like? How are medicines being used and symptomology? These are just examples. So for the research community, because ultimately, if we build this, collect data, and then don't use the data, that's really a disservice to the community. So making sure an appropriate way for access to academic investigators, industrial investigators, regulatory agencies, and other patient advocacy groups that are trying to advance their understanding of the mitochondrial disease community. This is meant to be for all those stakeholders. IRB is ethical oversight. That's ensuring that everything we're doing has been looked at through the lens of ethical oversight. Is it appropriate to ask for the kind of information we're asking for? And are we asking permission in the right way? And that's really important too, to the informed consent process. Anything that is coming onto mitoSHARE, onto this platform, will be either looked at by an IRB or approved by our multi-stakeholder governance committee that does include patients as well as clinicians, researchers, industry, and UMDF representatives. So in deciding what to make of the next one, first we settled on the name. We really liked mitoSHARE because so many of those goals that I've just talked about are predicated on sharing and building the case for why it's important to share and that you can feel confident and comfortable sharing your data. This is meant to be a registry for all. There are a myriad of registries available. We understand that in the landscape. This is the registry that every member of the mitochondrial disease community, whether a patient or a caregiver, should be a part of. There may be other more focused ones that you choose to join, but mitoSHARE is the one where we cast the net wide and fully understand what the community and how it's made up. Again, if we build something and it's not a robust research database, then we're really missing the mark. So that had to be done. And these support tools were really important to us as we designed it. So a couple examples of that as we launched were the ability for the patient community to better understand their genetic test reports. Part of the feedback we received is, I get a copy of my genetic testing report, and it's got a lot of technical language, and it's talking about variants of unknown significance and a lot of terms I don't understand. So the challenge is, if we ask a patient to go and get that report and pull information out of it and put it into the registry, there's a good chance, or at least a chance, that it won't be entered properly, that a mistake will happen because it's not written in a patient-friendly way. So instead, using the Matrix platform, we curate, right? We look at your report, you upload it into the registry. We have genetic counselors that are associated with the registry that can view the report and pull out the key information about which genes may be pathogenic or what a heteroplasmy level is. And again, understanding that perhaps some of these terms are unfamiliar to the participant, we've created a standardized form that has a lay summary, that has a description of what each of those means in non-technical terms, and that's returned back to the participant. So it's a win-win. For the registry, we get high fidelity information, meaning it's accurate because professional genetic counselors are pulling it out of the reports. And for you, the participant, you're getting back a summary that can help you better understand your diagnosis. And if you're going to see a healthcare, you can take that along with you. And it's a very nice summary of genetically understanding your disease. The second are these trackers, and there's multiple built into the Matrix platform. You can track your symptoms over time, medications over time, appointments over time. Yes, these are useful for research, but I think they're really helpful in many cases for families where just managing the disease and sort of understanding how it changes over time, depending on your memory alone, that could be really challenging. So you go to see a doctor, instead you now have a place where you can pull a report to say, here's how this symptom changed over time. I was experiencing this symptom and it was very severe 6 months ago, but now it's less severe or it's getting more severe. These are important insights that help support you, the patient, caregivers, in advancing your clinical care. So what have we learned since the registry opened 6 months ago? I can hardly believe it's been 6 months already, but it's really exciting. You know, it's the baseline when we launched the registry, we knew we wanted to collect information around demographics, meaning what is the makeup of our community, sort of standardized demographic questions, but then also what we call a diagnostic intake survey. And that's just helping to put the participant on the the spectrum, if you will, from maybe suspected, and I don't know if mitochondrial disease, if this is even the home for me, you're still welcome here as you advance your diagnostic journey, all the way through to the other side where a clinician has been involved and maybe made a diagnosis of some kind of syndrome, the classical descriptions that are used by so many doctors like Milas and Lee syndrome, et cetera, just a collection of symptoms, if you will, to that gold standard for any genetic disorder. And that's, I've had genetic testing and it's demonstrated that I have a genetic mitochondrial disease. All are welcome in mitoSHARE, and we encourage you all to join when you have the opportunity. We've tested the onboarding process registration. It should take less than 10 minutes. We've tried to make it a minimal burden to you. Just know that with all of these surveys, you complete them at your own pace. Once you have an account created, you can start a survey, stop a survey, your answers are saved. You can pick right back up where you left off and we'll continue. I'm just going to pause for a moment. I see the chat. There's a couple questions in there. I meant to say this from a housekeeping perspective at the top. We are going to collect questions. We're going to ask you to use the Q&A feature just to put your questions in there. And then as we get a little later in the presentation, I'll be happy to address some of the questions that may be there with whatever time remains from it. Again, we ask your patience and understanding. We may not be able to answer all questions in this environment, but please do ask your questions. I also have a representative from Across Healthcare. That's the technology provider that runs Matrix, Andrea Rogers. She is on the webinar as well. And so if there's specific questions around the platform and its capabilities, Andrea is prepared to answer those too. So what kinds of accounts? Again, we want this to be the registry for all. So it's patients, it's caregivers, and importantly, I think this is one way that this registry is different from any other that we're aware of. Clinicians are also able to join the platform. The idea being that a patient or a caregiver creates an account, identifies who their clinician is. And right now we have a somewhat limited list of doctors available. This will grow over time, but if you see your doctor listed there, you can associate them with that account. And that would enable then an exchange of information in a private way between patient and clinician. So really important way to do that. And we think going forward, there'll be other ways we can engage with the clinicians. But for now, it's really about facilitating optimized clinical care. So of course, the big number that we want to share today is that 6 months in, 863 individuals have begun this process of creating an account on mitoSHARE. This is fantastic progress. This is as of a couple days ago. And I think in the next slide, you'll see this is a number that's growing very steadily. So it's not predicated on a big push at the beginning and now it's slowing down, to the contrary. So that's a combination of both patients and caregivers. And you can see it's about 3/4 patients, 1/4 caregivers. This is fantastic, right? We need both as part of the registries. And for those of you that are not on mitoSHARE yet or haven't joined as a caregiver, you can create your account and then you can add patients associated with you. So there is a way to be able to get particularly minors into the account that are under the oversight of a caregiver. So you see some of the numbers here, over 500 patients, over 250 caregivers, could not be more thrilled, and 22 clinicians that are already on the platform and can be associated through the account creation process. So from a diagnostic point of view, this is a very high level snapshot, not meant to be in detail, but just to give you an idea of some of the learnings and what we are learning. For instance, through that diagnostic intake survey, we know that almost 80% of those joining have had genetic testing of some kind. That's very interesting in and of itself, that it may be, you know, 15 years ago, it started with a very specific panel, and then at some point there was a whole exome done. But a vast majority of the registrants have had genetic testing. So let's keep that in mind as I start to talk about some of our other findings. A little less than 60% have a genetic diagnosis. Now, based on what the clinicians publish in this space, that's probably not far off from being representative. That might be at the high end. I've heard numbers between 40 to 60% of our community. So whether it's 60% don't or only 40% don't, that's still a very significant number of patients that don't yet have a genetic diagnosis. And for all the reasons I mentioned earlier, a diagnosis is critical to optimal clinical care, and ultimately it will dictate your ability to be able to participate in a clinical trial that has very specific guidelines around types of genetics that can be involved in it. So these numbers start to give us an idea. A lot of people have had genetic testing, but maybe it didn't yield a diagnosis. So in terms of this curation process that I described, 41 participants have uploaded their genetic testing reports. 38 of those have been curated. And I didn't have a chance to check this, but I suspect that, you know, the two or three that haven't, maybe uploaded a document that wasn't a genetic testing report. So we just have to, you know, sort that aspect out of it. The genetic counselors that we've partnered with from Children's Hospital of Philadelphia are extremely efficient at being able to look at the report, extract the information, put it into this summary, and return it back to the patients. I think we're saying 30 days, but my experience is it's been happening even faster than that. This is a fantastic benefit. Two takeaways here. If you're in the registry, you've had genetic testing, and you haven't yet uploaded your genetic testing report, please consider doing that. Again, the benefit is to you in terms of having curation, but it also really helps to make our research database much stronger in terms of understanding these key research metrics of the kinds of patients that are in our registry. If you had genetic testing and you haven't yet joined mitoSHARE, I think this benefit alone is a really good reason to consider joining today. And we'll talk about how to do that later. So, you know, across 6 months and 800 some participants, we have dozens of various types of mitochondrial disease. Not surprising, over 400 different mutations have been identified that are associated with mitochondrial disease. So there's many different types of mitochondrial disease, but some of the most common I've listed here, like mitochondrial myopathies or depletion syndromes, MELAS, Lee syndrome, not surprising that they're represented well in the registry. I've pointed to suspected mitochondrial disease, and this just reinforces that this is a registry for all, even if it's only suspected. No clinical evidence or clinical diagnosis yet that is definitively mitochondrial disease. You're welcome in this registry. These are the patients that are on the diagnostic journey, and we're here to help. As you advance your care, as you learn more about your disease, the registry will be able to keep up with you, and hopefully we find ways to engage and really understand this important subpopulation of the mitochondrial disease world, those that are just suspected. Helping patients get to the right diagnosis, whether it's mitochondrial disease or not, is something that's a top priority for us. If it isn't with mitochondrial disease, we hope we can help you find where your community is. So again, continuing with the diagnostic journey, we're really learning about this challenge of diagnosis with mitochondrial disease. It's not simple. And of course, UMDF is starting to launch a number of initiatives to really address this gap of how do we get to more diagnosed patients. And our sponsored genetic testing programs are an important way to do that now going forward. But over 20% of the registrants are undiagnosed. This is a significant number. And again, if you believe, and there's every reason to believe, the epidemiology, like how common is something like mitochondrial disease, 1 in 5,000 as an average across all forms, there should be 70 or 80,000 people living with mitochondrial disease in the United States right now. We don't have anywhere near that kind of number in a research database like this, even in a contact registry, right, for UMDF. So there are undoubtedly a lot of patients wandering around other clinics with doctors that are not thinking about mitochondrial disease. So we have to raise awareness. Understanding this issue and using the registry to understand it really provides the power for us to go out and design programs to increase awareness around mitochondrial disease. From a demographic perspective, you can see that we're getting a nice balance, and the numbers earlier demonstrated this, but it's roughly two-thirds patients, one-third caregivers that are entering it. From a sex point of view, I couldn't help poking at my fellow men, Y chromosomes here. Why, men, why? If you look at registries, not just in mitochondrial disease, but really in any kind of health environment, female participation is always much larger than male. And taking this opportunity, if you're male and you're watching this, please join. We need the male mitochondrial perspective as much as the female. If you're female and you have a male in your life that is affected by mitochondrial disease, please encourage them to join. We need to make this as robust as possible across all genders, sex, et cetera. In terms of the patients that are in it, I decided to just show this as sort of a pie chart that really tells you whether it's a patient that's a few months old to someone that would be considered more senior, more mature in their 60s or even over 70, it's represented in the registry. And all are important, and we encourage everyone, regardless of age, to join. Frankly, these demographics probably skew towards older patients, more adult. We'd love to see more of the teens and minors and their data begin to be captured inside mitoSHARE so that we do have a good representation across all age ranges. I should have mentioned that this registry from a patient perspective is also open to deceased patients. The very first patient went in was my daughter that passed away in 2005 at the age of one. Data from deceased mitochondrial disease patients are important. Obviously, we can't track that over time, but it still provides insights or the opportunity for research insights from those patients. So if you're comfortable with it and you're open to it, I would encourage, if you've lost a loved one to mitochondrial disease, it's a wonderful way to honor their memory, to include their data in mitoSHARE. And you can see we have roughly 5% of our registrants currently that are labeled as deceased, and that more than half are between the ages of 0 and 20, and I suspect it's probably between 0 and 10. This is a global registry, a worldwide initiative. I'm really excited to say we have 21 countries represented inside of mitoSHARE. Folks from around the world are participating in it, although 85% are from the United States. These numbers actually track pretty closely with our experience when we ran Mitochondrial Disease Community Registry, MDCR, for 5 years. Very international, with a heavy skew towards participants in the United States. If you're not based in the United States, please join. We're going to continue to look for ways to strengthen our international interactions through the registry. So the last section that I'll go to here is what to expect, what's new and what's next. So in terms of what's new, we actually launched something really exciting just a couple days ago. And again, if you're participating in the registry, you should have received notification through the platform. But we also sent out an email, because when new things launch, we think it's really important to get it in front of the community and they can make a determination of, okay, I want to come back in and participate in it. In this case, these are health assessment surveys that are standardized by an organization called ClinGen. And what they do is they collect information, the so-called head to toe. So kind of starting with brain-related issues through muscle-based, maybe it's heart-based. There's a level one survey that just asks if you have symptomology in that system. If you don't, it moves on to the next system. If you do, it presents to you a so-called level two survey, which is a little more detailed. Yes, I'm having brain symptoms. Are you having seizures? Is it brain fog? Is it fatigue? And then it's information that would begin to give us an idea of when did these symptoms begin for you? how severe are they now, and a small bit of other information associated with it. So by doing this, we're getting a snapshot of the patient right now in terms of what they're experiencing with their health. But if we come back and answer this survey again in 6 months or a year, now we start to have changes over time. And if you recall from earlier, what I talked about, natural history data is how the disease changes over time. So this is a really important way for us to build natural history data on all the patients involved in mitochondrial disease. And again, for you as a patient, it nicely gives you an idea of what that progression looks like over time. And that may be useful in your clinical care. I just want to reinforce again, sometimes these things sound very complex and, oh, they're going to take a lot of time. Work at your own pace. They're designed to be as simple as possible. And hopefully you can finish the first assessment in 10, 15 minutes. And then if any level two survey, you can always come back and finish those later. So work at your own pace. But this is a really important component of building up patient data within the registry, within mitoSHARE. And those just launched a couple of days ago. So again, if you're a member, please go. You should see it on your dashboard. And if you're not, yet another way for you to get engaged and play your role in advancing the development of treatments and cures. So a few things that are just a little bit out, right? So we're on the patient side. MSeqDR is Mitochondrial Disease Sequence Data Resource Tool. That's a mouthful. We always call it MSeqDR. This is a close partnership, again, with CHOP, Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, who, together with other investigators, have created a central repository for genomic data. So if you noticed, I didn't discuss at all that you actually upload your genomic data, meaning the raw data that's collected once you have genetic testing. We're collecting the report because we really want to focus on the findings side of it. But the raw genomic data, so when every letter of your genetics or some subportion of it are read, those data are really important for research. So MSeqDR is now looking for patients who have every right to receive their genomic data when they've had genetic testing to donate that data into this repository. Again, it will only be used in a de-identified way. So mitoSHARE is just serving as the funnel, if you will. You join mitoSHARE, you have the opportunity to come in. An eligibility question will be asked, essentially, have you had genetic testing? And if the answer is yes, then it takes you to the MSeqDR site and the healthcare professionals there. If you don't have the data yourself, they can make it very easy for you to get the data and have it sent into MSeqDR. So this is about advancing research on the genetics of mitochondrial disease. We're working on other patient-reported outcomes, on specific aspects of mitochondrial disease. Those kinds of surveys will be coming in the near future. And for the caregivers, because again, roughly one third of our participants are caregivers, we really want to start presenting surveys to you to understand the burden of care. What does it mean on a daily basis to have a loved one with mitochondrial disease and to take care of them? So look for those surveys to launch soon that are very caregiver focused, not patient focused. And lastly, we're starting discussions with a group of investigators that are very interested in conducting research on specific populations of mitochondrial disease patients. We can go deeper on Lee syndrome. We can go deeper on MELAS. We can go deeper on any form of mitochondrial disease. But we want these studies to be associated with a researcher that has developed a protocol and had it reviewed by their institutional review board for ethical oversight that's appropriate before we would put that onto the mitoSHARE platform. So look for more details on these more targeted recruitments for mitoSHARE in the coming months ahead. So we're at 800 and some now. Our goal, our fiscal year runs through end of June of next year. Our goal is to increase that to 1,200 by end of June of 2023. Our mitochondrial medicine symposium will be in Charlotte next year, and I'd love nothing more than to be able to stand up and talk about how we hit not only 1,200, but perhaps a number even bigger than that. But that means we have to continue to reach out to the community and find ways to engage and make the case for joining mitoSHARE. So for those of you that have, thank you. Thank you. And thank you for all you've already provided. It's just the beginning. For those of you that haven't, please think about it today. If you have any questions, I'm always available. It's very easy to find me from the UMDF website, but we have a dedicated email address as well. Any questions around mitoSHARE, whether you're already participating or just thinking about it now, or just want to share your thoughts about it, registry@umdf.org. I promise you, I'm looking at that every day and really value your feedback when it comes to mitoSHARE. The link is here for how to get involved with the project. If you already have an account, you can use the same link, as you know, but those considering it, you'd also visit this URL. So I think I'm gonna pause there and maybe we can transition to Q&A. I'm just gonna need a second to kind of bring this up. So one of the participants today asked, you know, my specific diagnosis isn't in the pull-down menu. Others are listed, you know, will this be added? Yes, I think the pull-down list will change over time. There's always the opportunity to have other, right, as a category. And then in a more detailed survey, right, the detailed demographic survey or the diagnostic intake survey, there would be the chance to free text add that disease in. So again, with 400 different types of mitochondrial disease, we didn't think it was very useful to put all of those in a drop-down menu. We tried to focus on the most common ones, but we're always open to suggestions of how to tweak that list and improve upon it. A question was asked, I know my genetics. There are no providers near me. Can we work in telemedicine? I have a diagnosis. Yeah, so you know, I think telemedicine, telehealth is going to play an increasingly large role in the care of mitochondrial disease patients going forward. We don't currently have a telehealth component associated with mitoSHARE, but there may be some opportunities going forward. I would say, if you don't have a provider near you, the best place to turn to is the Mitochondrial Care Network, and perhaps my colleagues can put into chat the link for the Mitochondrial Care Network. These are roughly 20 sites around the United States where there is deep mitochondrial disease knowledge and expertise in clinical care and clinical trials. And many of them accept patients remotely or from distance. So that's the best way, if you live someplace where you don't have a provider nearby to you, to be associated with a Mitochondrial Care Network center. Let's see. Do we have a symptom list to offer others? I'm not sure what you mean by that. I'll just take it as an opportunity to reinforce again this head-to-toe assessment. The ClinGen surveys do have a very comprehensive list, but it's extensive list, I should say, but it isn't necessarily comprehensive to mitochondrial disease. We know there will be opportunities to present follow-on surveys that go deep on specific symptoms that are very well established as being part of the phenotype, the symptoms of mitochondrial disease. Start with the ClinGen surveys, and then if you think there's something missing, this is part of that feedback loop, please let us know so that we can think about how to close those gaps. If I'm undiagnosed, can I get my providers access to mitoSHARE? How best can I do this? Yes, so this is really an important question. Thank you for asking it. As I mentioned, there's some limited number of clinicians, 22 that are in the drop-down list, but we know there are hundreds, thousands of doctors providing care to mitochondrial disease patients, not just those 22. So if they're not on the platform, every participant has the ability to create a secure link to their data that they can then give to a healthcare provider or a member of their family, anyone that they want to share it with. The key here is the participant, the registry participant, is in full control of what they share. So there are even categories. So you don't have to share everything or nothing. It can be just specific information and with whom they share it. So create the link from inside the registry, and then you share it with your provider. That will work for anyone, not just those associated with the platform. Okay, I think those are the questions we had there. I don't know if there's anything else that we wanted to cover today. As I said, if anyone had any specific questions about the platform and how it works, Andrea is with us. I can always get her to at least pop on with her audio if those questions arise. But from a support point of view, registry@umdf.org or Matrix Support. They have their own dedicated support email. This is for questions like, I have to reset my password, or the screens aren't displaying the right way. So the technical questions of the actual operations of the platform, UMDF doesn't have the ability to manage those types of inquiries. So that's what the Matrix Support is there to do. All right, well, I think with that, if we don't have any other questions, I'm going to bring this to a close. Again, I want to thank everyone for joining today. I want to thank those that are in the registry, those that are considering joining the registry. And for those of you who don't, we understand. It's a big decision. But if you have concerns and questions, please reach out so that we can discuss them and see whether the registry is a good option for you. I also want to thank my colleagues that have been very supportive, including one that recently left. Many of you know Katarina Gray. She was serving as the registry coordinator. She left UMDF a few weeks ago. We're actively looking to bring someone else in to replace that position. But I'm here, promise every day to support this and make sure that it's successful. Also, thanks to Across Healthcare for all you've done to make this registry as robust as possible. We're really excited about the future and look forward to bringing you additional updates as we continue to learn more. Again, thank you. Everybody have a good rest of your day.